responsibility for your own failures. That's what we do as Christians. Anyway, so do I need to start the whole thing over again? All right, so I am not going to cry. That's it. All right, there'll be no tears. This last week, just so you understand what I deal with at home, one of my children, who will in fact remain nameless, I'm not going to throw them under the bus for this, got in trouble. And I am lecturing them, as I do on occasion, and I was pointing out how disappointed I was in the choices and the decisions that they had made leading us to that moment. And this child looks at me and says, "What, you're gonna cry like you did? You're gonna cry like you did on Sunday about it?" Right. Do you know? Yeah, laugh it up. It's funny. Do you know how glad I am that we have moved to a new house that has a torture room with a rack? Anyway, I'm not going to cry. But I was texting my brother about this because some of you may be wondering what is wrong with this guy. And there's no reason for me to hide this from you. Many of you probably can put the pieces together. So I'll just tell you. What I feel like is happening in this series, and the reason it is affecting me the way that it is because I feel as though I am preaching truth against what I have been my entire life. What I have made my life about, wanting to be somebody and wanting to have a name and have everybody recognize me and look at me, and I'm realizing that I spent 40-some years of my life, well, we can discount the first five. I wasn't doing much those first five. But post 5 years old, I've been trying so hard to find significance and value and worth in myself and my own actions, and it was never going to be found there. And so, like, when you realize that and you're preaching that, it just affects you. And so, get off my back. Anyway, all right. So, years ago, when I was heavily involved in pro-life politics, very involved in politics and the pro-life movement, I shared an essay, and it was a fictional essay. It was about an individual named Elliot. I cannot for the life of me remember what Elliot's last name was. But this whole piece was about how Elliot, when he was growing up, he was ostracized. He didn't fit in with all of the other kids. He was very intelligent, very smart. And so all of his kids were playing games and doing all of this stuff. And Elliot didn't want to have anything to do with it. So he was kind of always an outsider. As Elliot got older, he found his niche in science. He loved science. He was brilliant when it came to science. He understood formulas and he loved experiments and all of that stuff. So he kind of found his group. And in young adulthood, Elliot, just messing around in the lab, discovered a therapy that when that therapy was put with a certain regimen of drugs, would cure over 90% of all cancer. Like, it didn't matter what the cancer was, whether it was skin cancer or whether it was pancreatic cancer or stomach cancer. He found the cure, essentially, to it, because it was a gene therapy that he had found. And we know that the genes go wrong with cancer. And so you read this whole thing and the people's lives that are being changed and how this guy who was so ostracized suddenly becomes the most recognizable name in the world. And then you get to the end of the essay and you realize that Elliot had been an unplanned pregnancy and his mom did not think that she was ready to have a child and she had had an abortion and Elliot never lived. And I thought it was a really powerful essay at the time. What it's doing is it's showing the power of one life. Think of the millions of individuals whose lives were going to be altered by the life of Elliot, but Elliot was snuffed out. The millions of people not only who would be cured from cancer, but all of their relatives who would have suffered because they would have lost that person and watched them go through that. All of those people that would have been changed. And so I shared this and I thought, man, this is a powerful essay. As I've gotten older, I've realized no matter how well-intentioned that was, I don't like that essay. I don't like that essay at all. And here's why I say that. I've noticed that this tendency, and I did now that I look back on my involvement in pro-life politics, I see this tendency that flies in the face of everything we talked about last week. Why does life have significance? Think of that essay. Why were we being conditioned to believe that Elliot's life was worth saving? Because he found a cure to something that was going to improve all of these people's lives. Well, what if Elliot had been born and been a mechanic at McGonagall's his whole life? Is that life not worth saving? When is the last time you read a pro-life essay about how we cannot allow abortion because we wouldn't have that guy working as a mechanic at McGonagall's, raising his family, going to church, having his fair share of sins, and really living an inconspicuous life? We can't allow abortion because, look, we wouldn't have this guy working at McGonagall's. Nobody writes those essays Because what we do is we equate value and significance with what we do as human beings. That's what that essay was doing. It's why I feel bad that I ever shared that essay, because that's not the reality. We get this idea that our value is derived from our actions and our dreams and our achievements, and it is not derived from those things. God does not use our value system at all. What does he do? God literally breathes into us the dust of the earth. He breathes into us our value and our worth. Yeah, he breathed it into Elliot. He also breathed it into the mechanic at McGonagall's. And that life is as just as worthy of existence, because that life is valued and cherished by God. Do you know how freeing that is? I don't know if you've stopped to realize how freeing that is when you realize that's where your worth and significance comes from. You don't have to prove your worth to anybody. You don't have to work and try to impress your way into being loved and appreciated. So then what are dreams for? I've had dreams my whole life and things that I want to do. What is the value of ambition? We've clearly got that as part of our chemical and physiological makeup. So what is the purpose of dreams? All right, one of my favorite Bon Jovi songs is a song, don't laugh. One of my favorite Bon Jovi songs is a song called The Story of My Life. It's one of those that you people that just know Living on a Prayer and all that, you have no idea the wealth, the incredible wealth of music that you are missing. But anyway, The Story of My Life. This is the story of my life. I write it every day. And then he goes on and says, it isn't black or white, and it's anything but gray. Such a good song. I'm just gonna sing it. Can we have the track? No, I'm not really gonna do that. But anyway, I love that song. And that's what I want you to do for just a second. I want us to use that, because I think it's an effective way to describe our existence. Think of your life as a story that is being written and is being told. Can you do that? Think of your life right now as this story, and some of you have several pages that have been written in that story. Good moments and bad moments alike. And some of you are very young, and you are imagining what the future pages are going to be. But right now, think of your life as a story. If you think of your life as a story, you have one of two ways to imagine that scenario. Number one, you can think of yourself as the author of your story. You are the author of the story of your life. You create your own plot. And you control the action that occurs in your story, and you will write your own ending. That's one way to think about the story of your life, that you are the one who is determining where it's going to go and what it's going to do and what it's going to be. The other way to think of the story of your life is to not be the author, but to be a character. A character in a story that is actually much bigger than what you are. And you have the opportunity to control your dreams and align them with a much larger plot. Those are the two options. If our lives are stories, we can either choose to attempt to be the author, or we can submit to the idea that we are characters in a bigger story. So now here's the question that I would ask for you. How does pop culture condition us to answer that question? What does pop culture tell you to do with your life? To submit to being a character in a bigger story that you aren't in control of, or to be the captain of your own ship, to direct your own path, to take life by the horns and make it what you want it to be? How does pop culture answer that question? How does it condition you? I want you to take a look at, here's what I'm gonna do. Three songs to cover the three eras that are represented in this church. There is going to be a song to represent the older generation, and you all will identify with this song. I want you to look at the lyrics. You've sung this song, you know this song. I want you to look at the lyrics and you see what was it conditioning you to believe your entire life about this question. And then we'll do the middle group. I put myself in the middle group. We'll have a song for them, same principle. And then we'll have a song for the little people among us, okay? So here's how we're gonna do it. We've got Frank Sinatra to represent the older generation, and then we've got, obviously, Bon Jovi to represent us in the center, the pinnacle of music, and then for the younger people, we have cartoons. Can we please roll this? Take a look.
Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way.
And I ain't gonna be just a face in the crowd. You're gonna hear my voice when I shout it out loud. It's my
Don't do it. I can't handle it, so don't do it. All right. Three different generations, the same message. It's the same, I mean, Bon Jovi's even quoting Frank Sinatra in the song. And that's the message that culture has. It's your life. It's now or never. You make the rules. No rules for you. You're free. You determine what you want to be and what you want to do. Regrets, too few to mention. You do it your way. And that has been conditioned in our minds from the very beginning, from the start of it. Look, this feels empowering. That's why these songs catch on. It's a song that you play when something's gone wrong in your life and you're ready to say, I'm gonna take control of this. It feels empowering, but it's only gonna feel empowering for a while. And why? It will feel empowering as long as things go the way you want them to go. It's very easy to say, I'm taking control, I'm gonna be the author of my own life, I'm gonna chart my own course, and you feel really good about that until something doesn't happen the way that you intended for it to go. What happens when something doesn't happen the way that you had designed and desired that it go? What happens when all of my hard work doesn't pay off? Like I decide, I'm gonna make something of myself. And I start pouring myself into a radio show, and I send out all kinds of, this may or may not have happened, all kinds of demos to people all around the country, take 2 days off of school just to put CDs in packages and mail them out to 150 different radio stations in America. And I pour myself and my heart, or sorry, this person pours themselves and their heart into doing this because they're gonna do it. And they don't get a single response. I'm the author, though. I get to write my own course, right? I get to tell my own story. So why aren't these people doing what they're supposed to do? Because I can clearly show you on the next page, I'm supposed to be the next Rush Limbaugh. So why aren't they responding the way they're supposed to? I'm the author here, yes? What happens when the person that I want and I pursue doesn't want me back? That's the person I'm going to marry. That's the person who's gonna love me forever. And I'm gonna show them how much I love them. But they choose somebody different. Well, I thought I was the author of my own life, right? What happens when sickness hits at the worst possible time? You have prepared and gotten ready and you are on the cusp of something great and then you get a debilitating diagnosis. That wasn't on the page. That wasn't what I thought this was supposed to be. Suddenly you realize you aren't the author. You may want to believe that you are the author, but when bad stuff happens that you didn't plan on, you quickly realize you are not the author of your story. Authors are omniscient. They are all powerful in the stories that they write. They can write the endings however they want to. They can do whatever they want to do with the characters. Every character and every ending and every scene is within their complete control. You don't see an author that says, that kills off their main character and says later, well, I didn't want to do it. No, you obviously did, or you wouldn't have written it into the story, because that's the role of an author. But are those things within our power in our lives? They're not. You may want to believe it, and you may try to convince yourself of it, but they are not within your power. And when reality does not align with our plans, it is proof, whether you accept it or not, you are not the author of your story. You're not. We are characters in a story. We are characters in an account, and denying that is going to bring a very depressing life. And it's what you see all around you today. People keep going off the script that I write. I wrote that it was supposed to happen this way. I wrote that I was supposed to have a child at this point in my life. I wrote that I was going to be married at this point in my life. I wrote that I would have this kind of house at this point in my life. But these people keep messing with my script, and that's not at all what I've written for myself. Scenes that I create don't end up looking anything like I thought that they would look. And even the stuff that happens the way that I want it to happen, it doesn't last, and it doesn't bring me the fulfillment that I thought that it would. This isn't how I was supposed to feel when all of this stuff happens. This, friends, is where we Christians can be so incredibly grateful that Carl Sagan was wrong. That this life is not about find a project and try to make something of your existence. He was dead wrong when it came to that. God is writing something big. He is writing an eternal epic. It stretches back to before creation ever happened. That's when this epic started, and it is going to extend infinitely beyond the end of time. That's the story that is being written here. And you say, but I'm a tiny character, a tiny dinky little character among billions, not even millions, billions in an epic novel. Can I possibly be big enough to actually matter? If this epic started before time ever began, and it's going to end after time ends, it's huge, and there's billions of people and characters in his story. How much can I actually matter? Do I actually matter? Well, the author tells you. Flip to Psalm 139, if you haven't already. It's in your bulletin. You should have. You know what you're supposed to do. And look, starting in verse 13. The author answers your question whether or not your piddly little existence could possibly matter in his grand story. Verse 13. For you, the author of the story, you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know that full well because I'm one of them. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Can you pause for a second? This is not just talking about David. This is talking about you. This is talking about Eliot. This is talking about the mechanic at McGonagall's. He was involved in the formation of your, it doesn't matter the circumstances of your conception. You were conceived in a horrible act. A father, your father committed a horrible, heinous crime against your mother. God knit you together in the womb. Your life is valuable and it has purpose. The circumstances of creation and everything else that are going on in the world, it doesn't matter. This is truth being spoken to us. I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Verse 16, your eyes, the author's eyes, saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. Every day of my life was ordained by God before they ever. We are not mass-produced widgets. That's not what we are. We are not just excess parts that are thrown together. We are fearfully and wonderfully designed and made. Every human being, and it gets its value being having that breath of life breathed into it by the Creator. Every single detail of your body, of your intellect, of your emotions, my children, your emotions were designed by God, intended by God, and they are used by God, all of them carefully crafted. Everything that you will do, God saw beforehand. Every page has been written, and you were created for a specific moment in his story. You, personally, a specific moment, a specific place, a specific reason in the author's epic eternal account. And nobody else can fill that position. He chose you. He made you for this moment in this time. David said it. God has written every single day out. He has written us into his story. Can I pause for a second? Your conversations and your language that you used and your laughter and your struggles and your joy and your walks through the woods, everything that you do, God has ordained it. He has seen it. He has intended it and desired it. All of it has been written by God's hand into his story because he sees a purpose in it. Why do you think that you don't have purpose when the God of eternity crafted you for this time and this place and this moment? How dare you think your life doesn't matter? It matters to him. He puts you here for this moment in time. That is far from degrading our, I know we think, well, if I don't take control and I'm not the author, then am I really worth anything? You couldn't be worth more than being loved and designed by the creator of the universe. The story doesn't start and the story doesn't end with us. We are not the author of this story, but we have been given a unique role in his story that nobody else can fill. You know how empowering that actually is? We feel like it's my life, I did it my way, that's empowering. Let me tell you something. Actually sitting and realizing that the God of the universe designed me because he needed me at this moment in time to stand on a stage and tell people, 300 people, his truth in this moment. Do you know how awesome of a feeling that is? It's unbelievable, far greater than anything I could come up with for myself, that the master of the universe wants to use me to impact somebody else. Oh, you're a mechanic at McGonagall's. Oh, that's a pretty worthless job. I'm pressing a button at Chrysler all day long. That's pretty, no, it has nothing to do with the task. God has placed you there to reach other people that nobody else could impact, and he's using you. Can you stop and tell me what could be greater than to be used by the author of eternity, the author of this epic, the master, the almighty God, for his purposes, to tell his story? You cannot beat that. I don't care what you try to do. He invented you specifically to fill a gap in the plot of his story. There's nothing greater than that right there. There's no greater purpose you will ever find. See, that's why abortion and suicide is so sinful. That's why it's bad. Why? Because God has seen a gap in his story, and he's weaved together in the womb a being that he wants to use to fill that gap. How dare we take our lives away from him and service to his kingdom? It has nothing to do with politics. It has everything to do with the value and the significance of human life that doesn't come in what it does. It comes in what it is, a being crafted and made and designed and used by the author of eternity. If you're the author, those things like suicide, you could justify it. I'm the author of my own story, and if I don't see a point in my story anymore, then I'm completely entitled to end it. You can justify things like suicide because your life is your own, but your life is not your own. Your life belongs to your creator, who has called you and purposed you for this moment where you are. Regardless of your own emotions about that, we have a role in something that is much bigger than us, and the author has chosen us individually for that. Now, how does that change our perspective on what we go through? All right, I want you to stop and think about this because it's absolutely amazing, all right? I'll just use one example of what I'm talking about. You're hurt. Something bad happened to you. You were mistreated by somebody. Somebody went totally off script from what you were counting on in the story of your life. Right, you'd written how this was supposed to go out, and they did something to hurt you in the process. If you're the author of your own life, then that wasn't the plan, and your emotional response to that is going to be anger at them for screwing things up. It's going to be resentment. This isn't the way it was supposed to go. You're going to get ticked off. You're going to walk away from all of that. That's if you're the author of your story. But what if I'm not the author of my story? What if the pain and the hurt that I'm being asked to go through is somehow ordained by God to serve a greater purpose? If that's my understanding of how all of this works, if he is the author of my story, how does my forgiveness in that moment impact his story? Stop and think about this for a second. I was written into this story, into this moment, to deal with this particular hurt and to demonstrate to the world around me the grace and the forgiveness of my Creator who has called me. If I use that perspective and I respond to tell His greatness and His story, do you see how different of a response that's going to be? Do you see the example that's going to set for the world? When you realize you're not the author and he is, it totally changes how we respond to things. Stop driving yourself to create a legacy for your small, tiny, dinky little name. Stop it. Stop trying to create that legacy and realize, discover that your tiny, dinky little name is already known and it's already loved and it's already remembered by the King of Kings. Who else do you want to remember it? besides the King of Kings. And no, I'm not feeling a swell of emotion right now that's almost gonna make me cry. It's not happening, all right? Even if life departs from your plans, and it will, even if it departs from your plans, your meaning and your purpose is indestructible because it was written before time began. It was written in the hand of the Creator, and no man can take that away, regardless of what he does. You see, some people think of God's universe like this massive library, right? And there's all of these rooms in the like, there's millions, maybe billions of books right there. You can't read all those stories, and each one of those books is the story of somebody's life. We're back to Bon Jovi. The story of your life, right? You're writing it, and it gets put into the shelves in God's eternal universe. And so what you've got is you've got the science wing. And so you got all those scientists, and you can read their stories, and they lived a life, and they told a story, right? So you got the science wing, and then you can go into the art wing, and you can read about the, all these people's lives that lived over here, and so they've created a wing of God's universe, and you got the athletic office, the athletic wing, and you can go and read those stories of people that did these great things athletically, and they're full stories, and you got a Jason's wing of the universe. Bad bosses. All right, anyway, I was feeling myself when I wrote that one in there. All right, anyway, sorry. If this was the truth, if that's what it was, that God's universe was just this giant library of all of these stories, think of all of the forgotten stories that are in there that will never be read again, that will never be heard. They're lost forever. They're gone. But that's not what is happening in God's universe. That is what is happening in God's universe. An epic, eternal novel that is being written with billions and billions of characters, but there is one purpose, and there is one plot, and there is one final resolution, and your Creator has called you to play a part on one of those pages to push the plot towards that one final resolution. That, find a better life than that. Find a better significance than serving the Creator of the universe to push his plot forward. Nations and kings and orphans and cities and wars and crimes and destruction and deliverance and compassion, all of those things occur in this epic novel. But the overarching plot that you see on every page is that mankind's rebellion is stubborn. And yet what? I love this. Every page tells us how our rebellion is so stubborn, but God's love is simply relentless. It doesn't stop, and it overwhelms mankind's rebellion and mankind's sin. It conquers it. Every page of the story is telling us that nothing in your life will be as meaningful or as profound as knowing God and his love. There is nothing in this life that will be. You want other people to know your name. Let's go through the things that we think we want that are going to give us significance. And I'm going to show you this. You want other people to know. I always wanted people to know my name, to respect my name, people to recognize my name. In John 10, I'm told the gatekeeper opens the gate for him and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. You know what I'm being told right there? That the God of the universe already knows my name. Who in the world do I care about knowing my name? Who has more significance or power than the God of the universe? How can I top that? You want somebody to know your name. How about this? You want great wealth? Oh, we like great wealth. That's really great, isn't it? 1 Timothy, put your hope in God who richly provides us with everything for your enjoyment. As the video is playing, I remembered Ephesians 3, verse 8. Listen to what it says right here. Preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. You're not going to find any wealth greater than what you have. Your Father who owns everything, he owns all things, has given you everything. How are you going to beat that? You want a giant home. That's going to make your life significant, right? A giant home to live in. My Father's house has many mansions, according to one translation, many mansions. If that were not so, Jesus said, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? In other words, friends, your Savior is making a mansion for you that is prepared for you for all eternity. You're gonna beat that here? That's what I'm saying. Everything that we want, you want access to power. That's gonna bring you significance if you have access to power. How about this? Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Do you realize that the Almighty has invited you into his courts? How much closer to power do you think you can have and be and experience? That's the Almighty. Controller of the universe. It's really unimaginable I'm at a loss for words to try to describe this. I don't think any man can describe this. Tiny specks of dust. That's what we are. And we're given roles in the epic of the Almighty. That's unbelievable. And some of you say, doubters, you pouters. Well, yeah, but I'm not Moses. I mean, he's got Moses's out there, right? He's got King David's. I mean, that's a big role. He's got a John the Baptist. I don't have a role like that. I'm a mechanic at McGonagall's. I'm really picking on the mechanics. And I'm just saying, but that's what we say. I don't have one of these. You do realize what Moses went through and what Moses saw, right? He didn't get to go to the promised land. He gets punished. John the Baptist got his head chopped off. And David had a dude killed and lived his life in regret for that. I don't know that I'd be begging for one of those big roles in God's story. It doesn't always seem to work out so peachy. But I'm not Moses. That's what we say. I want a big role. Listen, this is important. The smallest role in his story is so much greater and grander than the biggest role that you could ever write for yourself. I don't know how to articulate that, but the psalmist did. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. Now, here's the thing that annoys me. We took that verse and somebody wrote a song, and that's all we sing of it. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Hey, you know it is over and over and over. And the best part of the verse we leave out. I would rather be a doorkeeper. This is the part of the song we should sing. It's not even in the song. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked, than have everything that the world can offer. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God. That's King David that is saying all of this. You do know doorkeepers are pretty overlooked, right? The guy that opens the door, nobody pays attention to the butler, unless it's like a murder mystery, because the butler always does it. But you open the door, and you don't notice the butler as you walk through. He doesn't get to walk the red carpet. He sweeps the red carpet when nobody's around. Nobody notices the doorkeeper. They're part of the background scenery. And look at what King David is saying. Okay, listen. It's coming right here. I put it in all caps, right? This is the high point of this series. Everything from this point on is just going to be downhill and you're going to be disappointed, okay? But this right here is the high point of the entire series. So please do not miss this, all right? There is no way that a king like David could find value in simply opening a door. He's commanding a nation. So he's not going to find the skill of opening a door super exciting or thrilling. It's not the skill that attracts him, right? Everyone opens doors. Kids can open doors. The significance he saw was not in the skill of opening a door in the kingdom of God. Are you ready for this? I'm building it up, all right? This is really, really big. This right here, people write books and volumes and novels about the secret of life, and I'm going to give it to you for free because it's not my secret. It's right there. It's plainly, in plain sight, right in front of us. David considered one day of ordinary, what we would call menial work, near to God, better than 1,000 days spent anywhere that he wasn't. What's the secret of life? It's right there. It's not the skill that is going to bring you significance. It's that David would be doing things close to God. That's the secret of life. That's the secret of fulfillment. Doorkeepers working for the kingdom are more celebrated in eternity than the most accomplished celebrity that's out there trying to write their own story. Why? Because doorkeepers serving the kingdom are near to the Creator. That's where the significance lies. That's it right there. Look at what we read in Matthew. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world? They write their own story and they do all of these great things, and yet they forfeit their soul. They did all of this stuff in the tents of the wicked. They spent 1,000 days where God wasn't. What can anyone give in exchange for their soul? You can reach the top of the, quote, ladder of success and lose it all. And so many people do. The significance of what you do now is determined by your connection to God. It is better to be a mechanic at McGonagall's who has a close relationship with Almighty God, who finds their significance in their relationship with God, who finds their worth in their relationship to God. It is better to be unemployed living on the streets with a close relationship with Almighty God than it is to be the President of the United States spending 1,000 days where God is not. You have got to grasp that if you have any hope of discovering the secret of significance and the power of life lived in Christ. Here, Christians, is what we can know. It's how I ended it last week. It's how I'll end it this week. A few things I want you to remember, all right? Number one, if your life doesn't go according to your plan, it is still part of a much bigger, grander story. Don't ever forget that. That God is writing his epic and he is using you and your circumstances to accomplish it. You can pursue dreams that the world scoffs at and they say those things are small. God doesn't see them as small. He rewards even cold cups of water that are given in his name more than all of the grand things that you could write in your own personal account. He uses every act of your obedience in every situation. When you are tempted with various things and various thoughts and various actions, your act of obedience moves his grand plot closer to its final resolution that culminates in the salvation of souls and life eternal in heaven. This is God's story that is occurring around us. And I have to tell you, if you belong to him, that's your story as well. What could be better than that? Father God, I thank you for writing this epic. I thank you for writing this story and inviting us to play a part in it. It is unimaginable that you, with infinite power and infinite dominion and omniscience and omnipotence, these things that we can't even comprehend, that you would be mindful of us, that you would see me in Greentown, Indiana, that's here for just a vaporous few years, here one second and gone the next, that you would see me and say, I want you right here, right now, to serve my purposes, to glorify me, and to bring others to know me as well. That's going to fill this page of my story. Father, I am not worthy of being written in your book, and neither is anyone else here. We are sinners, we are lost. We need redemption, and you have granted that in your love. And not only have you granted that, but you have asked us to serve a part in your story. Father, for the people here who have not yet submitted to it, who are attempting so desperately to write their own story, and they're finding nothing but frustration and depression, Father, I pray that they would put down the pen today, and they would submit to being a character in the greatest story ever told. That is our prayer. And we ask it in the name above every other name, the name of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, your Son, our Savior. And everyone said, amen. If you want to submit to that Savior, now's your opportunity. Would you come as we stand and as we sing?